सर हैज इट गॉन लाइव मिलिंद सर?
यस यस, एक मिनट मैम, एक लेट्स चेक, वी आर लाइव नाउ.
श्योर आशी, आई थिंक यू कैन स्टार्ट. Please start the recording.
Good afternoon to one and all present here. Today on World Students Day, honored by Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam's birth anniversary, I, Asha Khan, on behalf of the Department of Psychology of RD National College, would like to extend a very warm welcome to all of you. We are very grateful to have an overwhelming participation from more than 180 people across various colleges, including Jai Hind College, Narayan Zentai College of Commerce, MOP Vaishnav College for Women, Thakur College, Thakur Ram Narayan College of Arts and Commerce, Joshi Bedekar College Thane, SK Somaya College, Sophia College, KJ Mittal College, and various other colleges. Our theme is education and learning. Education opens up the mind, expands it, and allows growth and nurturance. Great education by great teachers has the potential to transform and bring about profound changes in one's life. Mission of education, according to Dr. Kalam, is the foundation to ensure the creation of enlightened citizens who will make a prosperous, happy, and strong nation. Dr. Kalam promoted education as the fundamental right of every child. He also rightfully recognized and advocated the fact that more people in a society are educated, the more they will provide a beneficial contribution to their environment. With this said, I would now like to begin by thanking our principal in charge, Dr. Neha Jagtiani, and the Hyderabad Singh National Collegiate Board. And of course, no program is complete without the firm resolution and unwavering efforts of the HOD of Psychology Department, Dr. Meghna Basu Thakur, because of whom this event has come to its possibility and who has given all of us an opportunity to learn and create awareness on the importance of learning and mental health. Having completed 21 years in our college, Meghna ma'am is the epitome of inspiration for all of us. We start the event with the presentation of a short video made by the Department of Psychology about Dr. Abdul Kalam.
वतन वतन मेरे आबाद रहे तू, हे वतन वतन मेरे आबाद रहे तू,
हे वतन वतन मेरे आबाद रहे तू,
मैं जहाँ रहूँ जहाँ मैं याद रहे तू,
मैं जहाँ रहूँ जहाँ मैं याद रहे तू,
वतन मेरे वतन,
हे वतन मेरे वतन.
तू ही मेरी मंजिल है पहचान तुझी से,
जहाँ भी मेरी बुनियाद रहे तू,
मैं वतन वतन मेरे आबाद रहे तू, मैं जहाँ रहूँ जहाँ मैं याद रहे तू, मैं वतन मेरे वतन,
मैं वतन मेरे वतन.
थैंक यू व्यूअर्स. We would also like to present a short welcome note to our viewers from our esteemed principal in charge, Dr. Neha Jagtiani.
Here's wishing all my dear students a very happy World Students Day. I'd like to welcome all the students for this intercollegiate webinar, Turning Today's Learners into Tomorrow's Leaders, on the occasion of Vachan Prerna Divas. I'd like to congratulate the Department of Psychology for their initiative in this program. I wish you all the best, and I'm sure it's going to be a great learning. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I now hand over the dais to Dr. Meghna Basu Thakur to introduce our first speaker for the day.
Thank you, Arshia, for the inspirational video. I would now like to introduce our first speaker for the day, our esteemed speaker, Mrs. Shreya Mehta. Mrs. Mehta is an award-winning visual artist who confronts questions of identity, spirituality in her vibrant, eclectic practice. She was born in India and raised in Antwerp, Belgium, where she attended her schooling, the Royal Academy of Art, as the first woman of Indian origin. I think this is a matter of pride. After graduating with the prestigious VRIKA award, she eventually settled down in New York, where she continues her practice of drawing. Shreya's work has a global presence and has been exhibited at galleries and fairs in New York, Dubai, and Mumbai. Her work, her paintings, can also be found in several prestigious private collections. Shreya has been invited to the Indian Parliament House to present Honorable Prime Minister of India, Narendra Modi ji, with her artwork, The Sweeper. It all began one day when Shreya wrote a letter to the PM's office highlighting why she would like to present the painting to him. She immediately received the call from his office, and soon after, she traveled to Delhi to meet Mr. Narendra Modi ji. The meeting was inspirational, not just for Shreya, but also for Modi ji, who got inspired by her and the artwork that she had done. And he himself wrote a poem for her in return. I would really like to read out this poem written by Modi ji for all our viewers. Art is worship and not just a ritual. Here, there is a trilogy of mediums, devotion, and achievement. This is the achievement flowing from the brush. Art conquers destruction. Art is blessings to dear Shreya, an art devotee. Written by Narendra Modi, the year of 2015. She is here with us today to talk about art as a career. Without further ado, I would now like to hand over the dais to Shreya. Thank you so much, Shreya, for taking time out and being with us. That was the artwork, excellent artwork done by Shreya Mehta and presented to Narendra Modi ji. Thank you, Shreya. The dais is all yours.
Thank you, Meghna. Thank you, Dr. Meghna, for this very thoughtful presentation, introduction. So students, today I'm going to tell you three stories, just like Steve Jobs did in his commencement speech at Stanford. I wanted to share three personal stories and hope you can relate to them. The first one is about growing up in a traditional home. I was my father's favorite daughter. Every Sunday, it was a ritual in our home. He and I would sit on a red sofa in the family room and have long discussions. He was a successful businessman in the diamond industry in Belgium. He left Mumbai for Antwerp, which is a small town in the center of Europe, 50 years ago. This was an industry dominated by Jewish people. He was an outlier, the outsider. He often told me stories about India, and he was a very, very big fan of Dr. Abdul Kalam. And he shared this quote with me while I was growing up. "Unless India stands up to the world, no one will respect us. In this world, fear has no place. Only strength respects strength." He was a very strong, aggressive talker. And me and my siblings, we saw him break down successful other men and just by his words. During those Sunday conversations on the red sofa, he expected me to share what was going on in my life. Those Sundays groomed me to be a big free thinker. During one of those conversations, I expressed that I wanted to be a doctor. Yep, a doctor. I wanted to be someone who finds the cure to cancer or some crazy disease, and I wanted to make an impact in this world. Much to my surprise, my father flipped out. The color of his face changed. And he said, that's not the life you're going to have. He said, all the women in our family get married, get an arranged marriage at a very young age. And he wanted that for me. I want you to have the life your mother has, a life of comfort, a life of raising children. You can't do both. That was his thought process. I was, you know, just dumbstruck. I didn't know what to do. I was crying for months. But I had to do something because I knew I was meant to do more. So I had to present another option besides getting married at the age of 18. I went to the town hall in Belgium. I looked at all the colleges and courses. At that time, we didn't have the internet, so physically went to town hall to look for things. I learned that an art academy wasn't too far. I could stay home and still take courses there. Science and art weren't that different. Both scientists and artists are people who research, who experiment, who sample, who explore materials and compositions, and we both share our theories with the world. I knew I had to challenge my father, and I wanted more out of life. I wanted to have those Sundays on the red sofa. I didn't want him to cut me out of his life. So I rallied my, you know, confidence, and I prepped a sound argument. The art academy wasn't too far. I could do art even if I got married. And it was so close to home that I would still be okay in getting married to someone that he would approve of. He was also guilty. He felt guilty. He was a loving father. He saw me crying all those months. So he agreed. So my first lesson is, if the path isn't available, the path you want isn't available, negotiate. Dr. Abdul Kalam also has a wonderful quote on this. When we tackle obstacles, we can find hidden reserves of courage and resilience we did not know we had. It is only when we are faced with failure do we realize these resources were always there within us. So maybe I was always meant to create art. It was only when I got resistance from my father that I found this path. So my next story is about art school. So when a student applies to art school, he or she has to submit a portfolio in Europe. I'm not sure how it works in India, but 75% is pegged to your portfolio and 25% is dependent on an interview. Till now, I was preparing for medical school and I had no portfolio. I didn't know what to do. So I applied and I got the interview. I walked in with a portfolio that was empty. I opened it and showed it to the 7 jurors who were deciding my fate. They were aghast. This was the Royal Academy of Arts. Students spend hours and days preparing for entry. And here I was sitting for an interview, speaking in English, and I had not even made a portfolio. Two of the jurors didn't even speak English. I told them my story. I walked in with nothing. But the alternative is that if I didn't get this, I'd be married off at 18. So I asked them, please take a chance on me. I said, can you grant me 6 months of probational admission? If I can pass the exams, I will continue. If not, I leave. Belgium is a very closed off country. Belgians were forever trying to defend their culture from their neighboring countries, France, Germany, and Holland. And they were not too welcoming to foreigners. And here I was, I looked different, black hair, brown skin. I even sounded different and I wasn't at all Belgian. How are you going to pass these tests? The university level courses are in Dutch. I said I would figure it out just take a chance on me. I attended college 8 a.m. to 6 p.m. and then I attended intensive Dutch classes 6 p.m. to 10 p.m. for the first 2 years. Those seven jurors took a chance on me that day in that interview room. They liked my audacity to challenge the status quo. They were artists themselves. They believed in the artist's credo to challenge the status quo. I was creative in my admission. I made the argument about art and science being the same. If science wasn't going to be available to me, I was going to be an amazing artist. The final presentation was an installation in a monastery. The dean started the graduation ceremony with one work, mine. I was the first woman of South Asian descent, also the first Indian, to graduate with a master's in fine arts from the Royal Academy of Arts in Belgium. I was also presented the Royal Art Award, Vrikka, at that time. I was beaming, I was smiling, I did it. My second lesson is, if this path isn't available to you, believe in yourself, it trumps all. The solutions will come. And now my third lesson, something that might be coming up for many of you. The third story is about getting married. By graduation, I had already met the man who was going to be my husband. His concession to me was he would let me graduate art school and then we would get married. I did not really know him. I didn't date him. I married him and moved from Belgium to America. I got married in December, I got pregnant by September, and I had a child by May. My typical day right after I graduated and got married was typical 4 to 5 hours of sleep and either taking care of my baby or in-laws, because I was in a conservative joint family in America. Who would have known? I became the caretaker and I just lost myself at that time. I was exhausted by 8 p.m. and I didn't have any friends and I didn't do anything for myself. If I was diagnosed, I would say I was suffering from depression back then. Maybe I should have visited this department of psychology much earlier. I was full of regret and I regretted being in this situation. I regretted marrying someone I didn't know. I regretted not having freedom. I needed help. I could have been learning. I could have organized my life so that even though I have a child, I could have still had friends and done stuff. But I was hemmed in, not only because of expectations of family, but I was hemmed in by my own insecurities. In 2008, after 10 years of this life, my mother-in-law invited me on a jatra, a pilgrimage to India. It would be my first solo trip for seven days without the kids or my husband. All I took was my sketchbook. It was probably the first time in 10 years I was by myself with my own thoughts and no to-do lists. The first thing I sketched were three monks walking into the light. At that time I was in Rajasthan. I took my photographs everywhere with my cell phone. And once I came back to New York, I started sketching. I found this newfound space in myself to create these works. And I started sharing these sketches with my friends. One friend was an art collector. He looked at one of those sketches and immediately put money on the table. "You are making me this work," he bellowed. "This is going to be the beginning of a very successful career. Just remember me when you get famous." And that was the beginning of my art career. From that point, there was no looking back. In 2014, I had a sold out solo show in New York City. The following year, I was invited to Modi's Lok Sabha office to present one of my works. The one that you saw earlier. I had taken care of my in-laws with care and with love for so many years. They saw what I had given up and they wanted me to be happy. I won them over. I credit my mother-in-law for taking me on that pilgrimage 10 years ago. So my third lesson is, if the path isn't available, find your silent champions. And Dr. Abdul Kalam's quote, it is very easy to defeat someone, but it is very hard to win someone. At this point, I'd like to share one of my works, because here I am sharing that I'm an artist. This is one of my works. It's a charcoal on watercolor paper, on a textured paper. This work was inspired by the poet Rumi. These are not my hands. This is not my skin. I am the soul that lives within. And this is about the true beauty that lies between us, within us. It's not about the skin. We are not just this superficial name or this face. There's so much strength within. And I just want to leave you with a few takeaways. Number one, get mentors. My father was my first mentor. He taught me how to be a free thinker. But I've always been seeking out different mentors in my life. And one of them is Javed Akhtar, who's also from India. When he saw my works, he went on to explain, Shreya, a skill or a degree is not enough. But how do you plan on using this art? How do you plan on using these skills? What impact do you want to make? All these mentors, they push you to think and they push you outside your comfort zone. Number two, preparation, creating goals in your life. Like Abdul Kalam's quote, never stop fighting until you arrive at your destined place. That is the unique you. Have an aim in life, continuously acquire knowledge, work hard, and have perseverance to realize the great life. But what is preparation without execution? Devoting time. Time is our biggest asset. Use it wisely. If you heard these three stories, you saw I had a very quiet 10 years. But during those 10 years, I realized the value of freedom and time. And since then, I'm making every moment count. I want to use my time to its fullest. And number four, failure. Fail fast, fail often. To give you a little snip of what it means to fail, I failed art in sixth grade. I failed art also in high school. I failed it twice. But that didn't stop me. I failed not because of what I was creating. I had failed because I didn't connect to the audience I was presenting to. So you won't be everything to everyone, and you can't please everyone also. You fail, you never give up, because F-A-I-L means first attempt in learning. And if you get no as an answer, N-O means next opportunity. So thank you for this opportunity. And I'm very excited to hear any feedback that any of you have. But thank you so much for allowing me to share these stories. And even though I'm an artist, I think connecting with my audience is the biggest gift anyone can give me. Thank you.
Thank you, Shreya. I think that was really, really nice. I mean, all your three stories were really inspirational. I think we will take the questions that have been posted on the chat. I think one of the questions that has been asked by the audience is, what was the role of your mentor, particularly in, besides listening to you, she says that it was your father, but did you have any one mentor who motivated you to get into painting?
Yes. So I really truly believe you shouldn't have one mentor. I think you need to have mentors for different parts of your life. For my art, actually, my mentor was Tao Poch Lin. She just passed away this year. She was the world's oldest living yoga teacher. She was French. And I started taking yoga. And one day I invited her and she saw my sketches. And every single time I attended a yoga class, she would push me. So what large, big new masterpiece have you done? When is the big exhibition you're going to have and you're going to invite me to? So she constantly pushed me to create works to share with the world. That was one part. As I mentioned, Javed Akhtarji, I met him 2 times. And both times, he always said, it's not enough just to make something and to present it. But really, how are you going to share it with the world? What is the message you want to create? What is the message? What is the impact you want to have? And that pushed me to think beyond just making a visual artwork and putting it in an fair. It pushed me to start talking about the work. It pushed me to start thinking about impact I can create with these works. So just a little bit about 2 mentors that I have.
Thank you, Shreya. There is another question from the audience that, do you think that education, excelling in education, whether it's art, commerce, science, that is more important or any performing art, be it painting, be it dancing? Because the girl who has written, she says that she doesn't enjoy studying, but she loves dancing. So what is your take on any other allied career to make you successful, identify and give you an identity rather than just pursuing education?
So identity is a central topic to most of my work. And one of the things I'd like to share is that in the olden days, in the Vedic systems, art, science, technology, all of these were one subject. So it's only in these modern times that we've decided to separate the performing arts from science or from commerce or from finance. But I will leave her with one thing, that even if you're going to be a successful, say, performing artist, say if it's a dancer, a singer, or an artist, you have to know how to run it. You have to know how to run a business. You need to know how to share the content with words. And therefore, yes, you do need to have skills. You need to have skills, writing skills, speaking skills, and all sorts of presentation skills, because they go hand in hand. But I would definitely say follow your passion, because that's exactly what I did.
Yeah. Thank you, Shreya. I think there's one more question from Anchita. And she says, as writers have writer's block, did you ever have a painter's block? And if you did, how did you overcome it?
So I think everybody has a block sometimes in their life. I guess I was pent up for 10 years and I was like dabaofied so much that I had a burst of creativity. And after that burst, I had a very big lull. I was lost. What should I create? One of the things I do resort to is meditation. I believe in the power of silence. I practice silence meditation, silent meditating. And I do wake up early morning. So even though it is 5 a.m. in New York, I am used to waking up at this silent time and taking that time every morning. Make it a ritual to have time for yourself, because that's the only time you find inspiration. And the only time you get blocks is when you have so many external obstacles that you can't think clearly. So my answer to that is find the silence within you. Have some time to yourself in the morning or any time that you find silence. And that's when you can draw inspiration. And that's for me, I start with journaling and I start pouring my thoughts out. And that usually helps me unblock my writer's or artist block at that time.
Yeah. Thank you, Shreya. I think we'll go with the question from Musan. And there is one question says that Muskan asks you this question, Shreya, that did you ever feel that you're going the wrong way when you faced failure?
So, yeah, I think most of us doubt ourselves. We all have this little bit of the imposter syndrome. I'm not good enough. You know, am I really supposed to be doing this? Maybe I should. We always doubt. But I do think it's very important to have that time to yourself, because once you write down those goals of where you want to go in your life, you look at that vision, you create your vision boards. And at that time, you can start creating that strength within you. Okay, you know what? I'm going to do this. And if it doesn't work, I'm going to do something else. But I am going to try my 100% at being present in whatever I'm doing. I hope that answers that.
Okay. And yes, and I think this is the really last question, Shreya. There's a student who says that she really enjoys painting. She thinks she's good at it, but her family does not support her. So what does she do? What advice would you have for her?
So I don't know her particular situation, but I don't think art is something you have to, have a large canvas and paint in people's faces, right? This is something that she could have a small sketchbook. Mm-hmm. And I think when you're faced with obstacles, you have to kind of start writing your thoughts down and creating this like mini sketchbook, mini journal, because great art is mostly created when you're faced with obstacles. Most artists, if they are told go be an artist, I don't know if they could create and they can generate the passion to share something with the world. So in a way, you're in a good place. You have resistance. Use those emotions, pour them into that little, into a sketchbook that you make when you have time. And there will be a time when you will be able to share this, and you are preparing for that moment. That's what I think.
Thank you. I think that was an excellent advice, Shreya. And I think I really align with you there, because even just like you, when I was young, and you know, when I told my dad I want to do psychology, and first came the resistance that this is not a subject to be done. It was looked down 20, 25 years back. And that's when, I decided, and I love your acronym and the full form of FAIL. You know what I mean? This is the first step, and it's okay to take it on. And it was a tough journey, but I think I made it. So thank you so much, Shreya. I really extend my gratitude to you for taking time out and sharing your artwork and painting. I think you're the first lady we've invited. I mean, I've had this talk, and I think my students love meeting you, because Narendraji Modi's painting, our poem for you, was so very, very inspirational. So thank you for taking time out. Ashia, I hand over the vote of thanks. You can propose the vote of thanks to ma'am.
Thank you.
I would like to express our sincere thanks to Mrs. Shreya Mehta for giving such excellent coverage on her truly inspiring journey to success. I'm sure, just like myself, a lot of the participants present here feel truly inspired, and we now have a broader perspective of the beautiful field of arts and the wide range of possibilities that lie ahead of us. We really appreciate you taking out the time to be a part of this program, as this session has truly been beneficial for so many of us. Personally, my biggest takeaway was how in so many ways, scientists and artists are not so different as we perceive them to be. And I completely agree that seeking mentors is really important, as we at the Department of Psychology have the pleasure of having Dr. Meghna Basu Thakur as our mentor, and we will always be grateful for her guidance. Thank you once again, Shreya, ma'am. It was an absolute pleasure listening to you, ma'am.
Thank you. And I would love to have the opportunity to meet you guys when I come to India at some point.
Thank you. Thank you once again, Shreya. So we do have our next speaker on board. So Janet, are we there? Janet? Mrs. Janet?
Yes,
lovely. So Riddhi, you can... Yes, thank you. So Riddhi, you can take on. You can unmute yourself.
Thank you, Meghna, ma'am.
Personal growth is the ongoing process of understanding and developing oneself in order to achieve one's fullest potential. It's an important component in maturity, success, happiness, and life satisfaction. Personal growth is also the foundation of emotional, physical, intellectual, and spiritual health. Successful personal growth requires motivation, the desire to improve, and the willingness to strive to make changes. Our next speaker is Mrs. Janet Gaspar Chaudhary. Mrs. Chaudhary has over 25 years of experience across consulting, FMCG, banking, and non-banking financial companies. Her last corporate role was director and CHRO of a 10,000-strong finance organization where she led HR, admin, corporate communication, and CSR. As director of PwC, she advised clients in India, US, UK, and South Asia. She has now forayed into education, running two ICSE and ISE K-12 schools, having 6,000 students. She has been educated at Harvard Business School, London Business School, Accelerai Jamshedpur, and St. Xavier's College, Kolkata. A mother of two teenagers, she is an avid sportsperson, having won tournaments in squash, badminton, and golf. She is here with us today to talk about personal growth and her journey with it. Without further ado, I now invite Janet Ma'am to address to the students. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you so much, Riddhi. And special thanks to Dr. Meghna Basu Thakur for inviting me here. It is my pleasure to be here and to address all of you. And I do hope that we can make the session interesting, because I'm going to be talking about myself and my thoughts, which for me is, you know, not a very interesting topic. For me, it's a little boring, but I do hope I can make it as interesting as possible for you. So the topic that I saw was turning today's learners into tomorrow's leaders, right? So the key words here we're looking at are actually learners and leaders. And today being the birth anniversary of Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam, we are celebrating World Students Day, which is extremely interesting. So I'd like to start by sharing with you a small incident where I had the good fortune to meet Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam. And this is way back in 2007 in Kolkata, where there was a seminar which was being held, and there were multiple speakers, iconic speakers from the corporate sector, from politics, and from various other domains. And the keynote speaker was Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam. And I was the person who was the anchor. So I had to effectively introduce every speaker, and then I had to do the closure and the thank you, something like what you guys are doing here, you know, the introduction and the thank you. But then the role was a little more, because I was not just the anchor. I had to even interact with the speakers to understand what they were talking about and kind of make them comfortable before they came onto the stage. And just before Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam was supposed to come on stage, suddenly the entire hotel, and this was at the ITC hotel in Kolkata, suddenly we found that there was a swarm of all these security people wearing gray safari suits. They kind of just came in and took over the entire place. And they started telling people to, you know, move from the first three rows, and they wouldn't allow anyone to sit there. Then they immediately got, you know, those stands with the dividers as we see in the airport. And they started putting the dividers all over, and there was just so much of activity going on that it became a little scary. And they clearly said that, you know, no one is going to be within that barrier except for Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam. And even I was thrown out from there. So it was all very overwhelming to look at all of this. And then, you know, the person who was the main organizer, he was allowed. And then he went and told the lead security person that, look, this lady is the anchor, and she needs to be on the stage to introduce Dr. Kalam. And therefore, she needs to enter within that, you know, scope, that area which you've cordoned off. So then they spoke to me, and you know, thankfully there was no lady security guard, otherwise I'm sure they would have been doing some frisking or things like that. But then finally they said okay, they allowed me, and then I said that I need to meet Dr. Abdul Kalam before that, and even that there was a problem. But then finally they allowed me to meet him. I was within that domain. I was on the stage with him, and then I got to meet him. And I have to tell you, after all this experience, my experience with Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam was exactly the opposite. He was a man of so much simplicity. The way he spoke, it was so calm. And despite his simplicity and the, you know, the demeanor with which he came in, he was a little stooped and he was bending and walking slowly. He just exuded such an aura around him. And that aura did not come from the way the security guards were moving around. That aura really came from what was within. And it was his knowledge, that power which he portrayed was simply because of his knowledge, his education, and his personality. So my take from this little interaction was that no matter how senior, famous, popular you are, simplicity is something, but your personality comes from your education. Your personality comes from the knowledge that you know, how you speak. And then he went on to speak something which is memorable. And of course, I will not get into that today, but the icing on the cake was, I was the only person who was able to get my book of India 2020, and we are in 2020 now, India 2020 autographed by Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam. So there were some questions in the previous session talking about, you know, different activities and education. I have to tell you, there is no substitute for education, whatever that may be. And that basic education is required. And as the previous speaker also mentioned, that you have to run certain things. So even that is required. So I'll share some of my, you know, little anecdotes as I go along. And let's move to the topic which I've picked up, which is today's learners and tomorrow's leaders. And therefore, let's look at learning as a topic, okay? One of the quotations of Dr. Kalam, which I really find fascinating, is all of us do not have equal talent, but all of us have equal opportunity to develop our talents. So all of us do not have equal talent, but all of us have equal opportunity to develop our talents. And so I'll talk a little bit about how we can use every opportunity to develop all the talents that we have. And yes, not everyone's talents is in academics, but everyone's talents are there in different areas. Let's not confuse education and academics. That's something totally different, okay? I'll start with another quotation, which I'm sure a lot of you have already heard. And this is Mark Twain, who has said, "Don't let schooling interfere with your education. Don't let schooling interfere with your education." And that's why I say academics and education are two different things. And education is learning, learning for life. Of course, we all go to an institute and we interact with professors. It is a window to the world. We make friends, we build a network, we get a structure. All of that is academics. But then an institute is not just academics. You have an institute for dance, you have an institute for art, you have an institute for theater. So all that is also education, not just academics, which is, you know, theory and, you know, what a lot of people do not like. But learning can be done from various sources. And I like to talk about a few things that have impacted me and my learning. The first thing that I would like to suggest as learning to help you for the future is travel. Travel really opens the world to you. You learn about geography, you learn about history, cultures, practices, cuisines, and so many other things. And you don't have to travel around the world. India itself is a microcosm of the entire world. The cuisines are so different from Gujarat on the west to Andhra in the east, or Kashmir in the north and Tamil Nadu in the south. The practices are different, the cultures are different. There's just so much of history. So travel opens the world to you. Travel is one of the ways in which we can learn and educate ourselves. And an interesting story I'll share with you is I have a very close friend whose daughter has cerebral palsy. And she was chatting with me once, and somehow in the conversation, she mentioned that her daughter's exams are starting from so-and-so date. And this is not in the COVID time, okay? It's about a few years ago. And she said that my daughter's exams are starting in these 2 days, etc. And then she said that, oh, we are going on a holiday. And I was surprised and I said, what? Didn't you say her exams were going on and you're going on a holiday? And she said, yeah, I'm going on a holiday because exams have no meaning for my daughter. I really don't think that she's going to learn anything during those exams. But during that time, if I take her away for a holiday, she will learn culture, she will learn history, she will learn lots of things. And that is education for her. And she says, every year during the exams, I take her away for a short trip because I feel that is far more educative for her than an exam. And I found that really profound. That yes, what does exams do to us? Yes, it does check our knowledge, but are we really learning? I don't know. So travel is definitely one way which opens the world to you. The other way that I have learned is reading books. Nonfiction. I feel nonfiction more than fiction opens the world to you because nonfiction talks a lot about reality. And there are a lot of biographies, there's history, there's multiple topics that you can pick up. And a vociferous reader is always identified by her knowledge on multiple topics, her vocabulary, her command over a language, and is always an interesting person to interact with. Of course, nowadays we do find a lot of movies are made out of books. Well, it's not the same thing. Movie has a completely different genre. So you enjoy movies for what they are. But books are something which are different and it immerses you in an experience and of course builds your character and personality. But I'm sure a lot of people will say, where's the time to travel? Where's the time to read? There's just so much going on. Well, I have a small trick. Some of the things, and I of course cannot travel to all parts of the world, but one of the things you can do is you can watch documentaries. You can watch documentaries on National Geographic, Discovery, Fox History, Fox Traveler. And of course, you can watch, you know, movies to understand at least reality about, you know, there's a lot of true stories going around. So these are things that, you know, we can use in terms of travel, books, to kind of open our minds and educate ourselves. I also find interacting on seminars like this or watching TED Talks something which gives me a completely different perspective because you get into the lives of people, you understand what they are all about, you understand their experiences, and personally, it has really benefited me. So that's one tip that I would like to share with you. The other one is that today in this online world, it has opened a new world for me. Because now I see that there are so many online courses available from leading universities around the world. And of course, they were there earlier, but I'm sure people did not do it with as much gusto as they do today. And as you heard Riddhi say, I currently run schools. I have exposed my teachers to these online courses. And it's very interesting to find how there are courses on how to teach online, there are courses to build your managerial skills, there are courses to build, you know, how to interact with parents as a school administrator, and these are all done online. So it's very easy to learn nowadays. You don't really need to be in an institute, but you can get educated and build your knowledge base by doing these online courses. The other tip that I would share my own experience is playing games. I've always been into sports. I've always enjoyed them. But I have to tell you that the amount you can learn from sport and playing any kind of sport is unimaginable. And I'll share a small experience, which a few years ago, I was playing a squash tournament and I was playing the final. And my opponent actually happened to be a very young girl who was half my age, literally. And of course, much swifter on the squash court. And a squash game, for those of you who are not fully aware, it's a five setter. Like tennis is a six setter, squash is a five setter. So I played the first game and I lost. And I played the second game and I lost. I had three games to go. Of course, if my opponent won the third game, she would have won, because it was 3-2, whatever would have happened. So as soon as your three games up, you've won. So I was two games down, and it was the tournament, the final. And that's when I started putting my mind together, and I thought, okay, what are her weak points? What are my strengths? What can I leverage? How can I change the game in my favor? What can I do differently that I did not do in the previous two games? And all that I did in that little break between the two games. And that first two games, I really watched what she did and why I lost. What did I do wrong? And then I came back in the third game and I won. So it was two games in her favor and one game in my favor. And then I came to the fourth game where I remember defeating her at the score of 6. So she was 6 and I won the game on 11. And we were two games all. And so that last game was actually the decider. And in the last game, I remember I defeated her under 5. And it was unbelievable how I managed to come back from being two games down to winning that. And I can attribute that today primarily to my experience, to my awareness, putting my mind to it, and thereafter going ahead and winning. But that was just one game. What I've learned in my entire life of sports is that sports really teaches you to focus and concentrate. It teaches you strategy. How are you going to win a game? It teaches you teamwork if you're playing a team game, or it teaches you how to lead others. And you see so much of it today. Dedication and discipline and hard work are unparalleled if you have to be a great sports person. And the most important thing that I learned is how to handle failure. You don't always win. You also will lose. And handling failure is really, really important. And the earlier speaker spoke about an acronym FAIL, which is again an Abdul Kalam quotation. It's the first attempt in learning. So when I failed, I understood what I did wrong. And then I moved towards winning the next time. In today's world, a lot of youngsters, and I've seen, you know, my own kids, everyone only wants gratification. Everyone wants appreciation. We put up, you know, posts on Facebook. We put up posts on Instagram only because we want to know how many likes we got. Or, you know, we want to talk about, how good I look on the social media. And everything is about feeling good. But that's not the real world. The real world, there is a lot of failure. And we have to learn how to manage ourselves in that, stand up and move on. And therefore, these are some of the areas: travel, reading books, maybe watching documentaries, interacting with people, listening to talks, doing short-term courses, and playing games. These are some of the things that personally I feel have contributed a great deal to my education, other than the fact that I went to certain universities and colleges and got a degree from there. But that's it. That's just a degree. Yes, there's lots that you learn around that. And I must tell you that I went to XLRI in Jamshedpur. And one of the scariest things about it was when I went, I found out that in a particular term, if you got 2 Fs, or not in a term, sorry, in the entire year, if you got 2 Fs in any 2 courses, you had to leave. And if you had 1 F and 2 Ds, you had to leave. And the courses were really tough. And there was just so much going on in XLRI that I was always psyched up that, you know, I'm not going to be able to make it. But then that didn't happen, because today I really don't remember too much about the subjects that I learned. But I do remember how I worked as a team. I remember how I managed stress. I remember how people helped out each other. I remember how I interacted with professors. I remember how I cracked cases. I remember my life skills. I don't really remember too much about which question and how I answered and what marks I got in which paper and what grade I got in the other project. I don't remember. And I'm sure all of you who are now in college or pre-university, I'm sure all of you will not remember how much you got in maths in class 6 and how much you got in maths in class 7. So why do we focus so much on all of that? Let's focus on the life skills. Let's focus on what will educate us. And those skills are something which I'll talk about now. So I talked about knowledge in the first part of what I said. And the skills that I feel are very important today is the learning orientation, curiosity, inquisitiveness. And you remember the movie Three Idiots, where Amir Khan talks about, you know, being curious and making things out of, you know, your own inquisitiveness. Yes, you apply the knowledge of physics and electricity, but then you need to do things, you know, which are beneficial for you. And here there's another saying by one of the favorite icons of all time, not just for me, but for others, Steve Jobs, which he said, much of what I stumbled into was following my curiosity and intuition turned out to be priceless later on. And today we all know where Apple is because of his curiosity and started in a garage. So learning orientation, curiosity, and inquisitiveness is something that will always be with you throughout your life if you can cultivate it today. The other thing is communication skills, confidence, poise, articulation, wit. All of this make you a personality to reckon with. I'm sure a lot of you have heard of Sadhguru or even watched some of his videos. Some of you have even watched him live. I had the good fortune to watch him live. The way he speaks, you know, with his humor and so much of content, you want to listen to him. Whether or not you follow him as a guru is not the point. The point is that the way he speaks, you want to listen to him. The other person that I really follow is Barack Obama. The way he speaks, you want to listen to him. And that's where you need to cultivate your skills of communication, confidence, poise, backed with humor, articulation, so that you are able to build your personality. The third skill is structural thinking, logical thinking, analytical ability. This is something that you need to build, and it takes time to build it. But if you can, then you become very insightful. Time management, planning, organizing, stress management, there are lots of skills. And nowadays, there are so many tools, there are apps to help you, reminders, calendars, to-do lists, simple breathing techniques. You know, you have apps on your phone, apps on your watch, apps on your, you know, wherever to drink water. I mean, all of it kind of helps us to plan and organize our lives so we can be as stress-free as possible. And finally, I'd like to tell you one last skill, which I think is really, really important, is building EQ or emotional quotient. And that emotional quotient is your ability to understand the other person, to understand the situation and react accordingly. I think I'm running out of time, but I will still share with you a small story on emotional quotient. When I was in PwC, my boss was someone who was very, very short-tempered, fly off the handle very easily. And he used to really stress me out in the beginning when, you know, he joined my practice. And I used to find that every time something went wrong, you know, he would just react completely like a volcano. And after some time, I chatted with another super boss of mine and I asked him, what do I do? Because he just stresses me out. I mean, but how can I handle it? He said, just talk to him. Go and talk to him. I did that. I actually took a flight out of Kolkata, went to Delhi, and I told him, I want to speak to you. It took a lot of courage because everyone was so scared of this man. And then I told him, I said, you know, this idea of you flying off the handle every time something goes wrong is not good. It just psychs everyone out. It stresses me out. And it'll just impact the performance. You need to do something about it. And he turned around and told me, I know, but what do I do about it? I don't know what to do about it. And that took me off guard. It was like, okay, he knows that he flies off the handle, but he doesn't know what to do about it. So I remember something that I read somewhere. I told him, look, each time you feel that way, count to 10. And after that, you'll find you're calm enough and you react accordingly. So that was my conversation with him. A couple of weeks back, there was some major issue that happened. And I remember telling him about it. And, you know, this thing happened, that thing happened, whatever. And he was silent. I looked at him and I said, why are you silent? Did I say something wrong? And he looked at me and said, I am counting. So that's where emotional quotient makes a big difference in how you, whatever you learn, how you lead, and how you are able to make a change. So I leave you with some thoughts towards the end as to how a leader, how a learner can, you know, become a leader. And my tip is, make yourself a brand. Build a personal brand for yourself. You learn every day, whether it is a sport, whether it's a language, whether it's a skill. You need to keep your brain sharp, because younger people will always come and take your place. And here I remember I was on a flight once with Sunil Gavaskar. Our flight was delayed, so we spent quite a bit of time chatting in the lounge. And I asked him that, how do you feel that you were called the little master and today Sachin Tendulkar is called the little master? And he thought about it and he nodded and he said, younger people will always take your place, but I'm not yet redundant. And I still am sought upon to do commentaries and do various other things in the world of sport, and people still remember Sunil Gavaskar. So yes, there was a new person who came in and took his place, but he kept his mind sharp. And a leader who is not someone, is not only a Mahatma Gandhi or a Martin Luther King who, you know, people follow. A leader is someone who is first, who is innovative, someone who everyone looks up to, and someone who you can learn from. So be a brand so that you can lead. Think of some of the greatest brands. You know, think of Apple, think of Coca-Cola, think of Maggie. These are all brands. And see why you like them. See what is, you know, so great about them. They've carved a niche. So you carve a niche for yourself. Build a particular personality. Today, when we hear Shashi Tharoor, we think, oh, voluminous vocabulary. Yes, that's him. He's a brand. Look at the other brands like Apple. They're always genuine. And you have situations where people can opt for another phone, but they'll go for Apple. Or they can opt for, you know, a Dell laptop. They say, oh, no, I'll go for a Mac. Maybe more expensive, but there's something about the brand that really clicks with some people. Be consistent. A brand is not something that changes year on year. A brand is something that you have to build, take time, and be consistent. Look at Maggie Noodles. I grew up with Maggie Noodles. You've grown up with Maggie Noodles. It tastes the same for the last 20, 25 years. It's consistent, okay? So I'd leave you with this thought. Make a brand of yourself. Whatever you learn in whatever way, don't let school interfere with your education. Learn from everything and then become a leader. Build your own personal brand. Thank you so much. If there are any questions, I'm very happy to take them.
Thank you, Janet. I think that was an extremely motivating talk. There are a couple of questions that have come on YouTube Live. So one of the questions a student asks is, how do you handle your teenager's failure, if any?
And are they talking about my own children failure?
Yes, yes, yes. They're talking about you. They've written your teenagers.
Okay. So first, I don't compare both my children. And I have always told both of them that I will give both of you equal opportunity, but you have to make it yourself. Each one has their own talents which develops in future. So as soon as there's no comparison, there is no failure. Because failure is always relative to something else. So I've done something and I, you know, did not do too well in it. That's fine. Get up, learn, and move on. And that's what I believe. Never compare anyone with somebody else. Because as I told you when we started, and I told you about Abdul Kalam, that said, all of us do not have equal talent, but all of us have equal opportunity to develop our talents. So that's the only way that you can deal with failure, and that's the way I've been doing it.
Thank you. Thank you, Janet. There's another question from the audience saying, is it all right to change your career path? Is it all right to change your career path, or will you be considered as a loser?
Okay, very interesting question. I have changed my career path twice. So when I was in school, my father wanted me to be a doctor. I think everyone's parents want their child to be something which they were not. So my father wanted me to be a doctor, and therefore I studied science, and therefore I did all the medical entrance exams. And then I decided I don't want to be a doctor. So I just completely changed, and I moved from studying science in class 11 and 12, which is your pre-university. I completely changed my line, and I went into English, and then I went into management. So that was the first change I made. And no one ever asked me, why did you move from trying to be a doctor into this? I just moved on. And then after being in the corporate sector for 25 years, I moved to becoming an entrepreneur. I never worked in the education sector. I was always in consulting and finance. And today I run schools. I deal with teachers, no longer those from the management sector. I deal with students. So I made a change in my career. The important thing is for you to be true to what you're doing and do it well. So it doesn't really matter if you make changes.
Thank you, Janet. There's another question that has come up saying that, does your personal growth involve spirituality? Do you believe in meditation? Do you believe in spiritual health? Personally, do you practice it?
Very interesting question. I follow the Christian religion. And as a child, I was taught to go to church on Sundays. And when we were in school, we used to also go to church on Fridays and Sundays. And, you know, I used to do that by rote. But then as I grew up, I started realizing that it's important for me to understand what I do. And so today, I don't necessarily go to church every Sunday or listen to mass every Sunday, but I believe it. So when I feel like, I read the Bible. When I feel like, I say a few prayers. I saw there are some Christian students here, so you will know there are a few saints that I completely follow, one being Saint Anthony. I'm a huge fan of Mother Teresa. She and I share a birthday. And I've spent most of my life knowing her personally. I represented India on behalf of Mother Teresa in the Vatican. And all of this is because of my belief in spirituality and not necessarily being religious. But the other part is, as I have now realized the need of meditation, and I do yoga as well. And I find yoga has a tremendous calming effect. So meditation is something you can do anytime, anywhere. And recently I have discovered this fantastic app which does yoga and meditation called CureFit, which makes me do meditation at night. So I do it in the morning because that's my time to do yoga and meditation other than when I play games. But every night, 15 minutes, I do meditation, which calms me and helps me to forget everything going forward. And I strongly, strongly believe that all of us should have a moment in our day that we need to put aside for meditation. And I have been inculcating that in my children as well. There is something called Super Brain Yoga, which you can Google up and find out. Excellent for kids. Excellent even for youngsters to bring in concentration and focus. Super Brain Yoga is something that takes 2 minutes to do and has a fantastic effect. So yes, that's my little brush with spirituality.
Thank you so much. I think that was the last question that came in, Janet. I think that was a very motivating talk. I will hand over the dais to Riddhi to propose the vote of thanks, please.
Thank you, Meghna ma'am. And thank you, Janet ma'am, for this inspiring and enlightening talk. It truly was an honor to have you here with us. Your journey and growth were truly motivating for all of us here present. I hope we can accomplish and embrace your journey of growth and success. Thank you.
Thank you, Janet. Thank you so much for taking time out of your busy schedule and sharing your stories. Janet was my school friend. We studied till class 10 together in Loreto House. She was the school captain. I have personally known how she has grown, and she was an excellent captain during school days. So once again, I extend my gratitude to you, Janet. Thank you for sharing your story with us. And I think the students have got a good take-home message. So please practice. I think that was power yoga. What was that, Janet? The last bit, the super brain yoga. Okay, good. I think that's a very interesting take. Thank you, Janet. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
So over to you, Vaishnavi.
Thank you, Meghna. Education is necessary for the growth of any country. In India, women have traditionally been confined to household work and taking care of the family. Patriarchy being the root cause, many did not believe in educating women. Instead, a female child has been seen as a burden, and getting married as the only way to get rid of her. Lack of support, safety, and the rising crimes against women prevent them from receiving an education they deserve. Joyce Band rightly quoted that the seeds of success in every nation on earth are best planted in women and children. With this being said, I'd like to introduce our next speaker, Dr. Kanika Ninave, who is in herself a living example of what we call an avid learner. With her unending desire to learn and her strong drive to excel in all her endeavors, Dr. Kanika, currently working as a clinical psychologist at KM Hospital, has a lot of experience under her belt. Her academic excellence is not just all that she's got. Kanika ma'am is also a professional Bharatanatyam dancer. With her multifaceted skills, valuable experiences, and unending desire to learn, she strives to make the most out of her skills. Dr. Kanika, who serves as an example to many more girls, shows us that the sky is the limit when you believe in your power.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So,
welcome, Kanika. Welcome. This is Dr. Meghna.
Hi.
Hi.
Hi, Dr. Meghna.
How are you, Kanika? Yes.
I'm doing
You're
good.
Most welcome. Thank you.
Okay. So, I'm going to start my talk today, and I'm going to be presenting to you. So, I'm just starting that. Give me a moment. Okay, is it visible? Can somebody please tell me?
Yes, ma'am, it's visible.
Yes, ma'am, it's visible.
Okay, cool. And I'm pleasantly happy to listen to a few boys, and I may sound a little too much for them maybe, but okay. So today I'm going to be talking about women's education and girl power. So something I am quite passionate about, the idea of gender equality and the idea that we are all capable of becoming equal, at least in an utopian head of mine. Okay, so what is empowerment? Empowerment is a process whereby individual is able to organize themselves to increase their own self-reliance, to assert their independent right to make choices, and to control resources which will assist in challenging their own subordination. In short, women empowerment refers to increasing the spiritual, political, social, educational, gender, and economic strength of individuals and communities of women. Feminist notions of empowerment have moved from power over to power to. Power over generally would refer to controlling power over someone and something. Response to it can be compliance, resistance, or manipulation. But we're trying to say that we want to give power to, which is generative or productive power that creates new possibilities and actions without domination. So what is the need for women empowerment? Can we have a little participation? Is that okay? Can somebody answer? Why do women have to be empowered? Why don't we talk about men empowerment?
Ma'am, may I?
Yeah, please, go ahead.
Ma'am, I think we talk more about women empowerment is because women have been declined their rights ever since the start. And in today's world, it is very necessary to educate women about what they stand for and what their rights are and what they're capable of.
Absolutely. That is absolutely true. And that's what we're going to look at. So what is the need of women empowerment? They are deprived, like she rightly said right now, of decision-making power, freedom of movement, access to education, access to employment, exposure to media, and, you know, domestic violence. So if you see that there are so many spheres in which women have had to face a tough time. When it comes to decision-making, the number of decisions women make jointly varies positively with education and non-linearly with wealth. Means what? That women who are more educated are likely to make their own choice. However, there is no linear relation with wealth, which means that irrespective of how much wealth I have, if I don't have education, then there is no straight relationship between I have more money so I can make more decisions. Okay, in fact, what they have seen is that if women have control over their earnings, they seem to have greater participation in decisions. But if they do not have control over their earnings, then they may have a very small say in joint decisions that are made. And unexpectedly, what was found is that the number of decisions are largely made alone, and alone meaning by the man. Freedom of movement. Women's freedom of movement is severely curtailed. Only 1 in 3 are allowed to go alone to a market, the healthcare, and outside the community. Now, don't think of us in an urban city like Bombay. Think of women at large in our country, coming from different sort of sects, different castes, different communities. And you will realize that we are very privileged as compared to them. But a lot of them are not even allowed to go and buy vegetables. So, you know, I have a lot of patients and we've actually been flabbergasted when we are told, oh, she doesn't buy vegetables. We get everything for her. They're supposed to just be at home. Women face a large number of hurdles in accessing healthcare. This is also one of the reasons why a lot of women suffer neglect medically because they don't have anybody to take them to the hospitals and they're not allowed to move out alone. Access to education. If you look at children's school attendance, only 2/3 of girls and 3/4 of boys aged 6 to 17 years are attending school. The sex ratio of children attending school is 8.99 girls per 1,000 boys. So quite clearly, there's a disparity there. If you look at the literacy and educational attainment among adults, 41% of women aged 15 to 49 have never been to school. That's a large chunk of women who have never been to school. Educational attainment remains very low, even among 20 to 29 age group. Only 27% of women have 10 or more years of education. That's an even lower number. The percentage of ever married women with 10 or more years of education has risen very slowly from 11% in the first National Family Health Survey to 17% in the third National Family Health Survey. Access to employment, which is again a corollary to education. The relationship of employment and wealth for women suggests that for many, women employment is largely a result of economic necessity, which means that women are forced or pushed into earning, not because they want to, but because the family cannot sustain if the woman is not earning. Even with controls for education, age, and wealth, marriage is negatively associated with a woman's likelihood of being employed and is positively associated with a man's likelihood of being employed, which is unfortunately very true. A lot of women also face what is called the glass ceiling effect. So even if they are doing well in their corporate lives and careers, they seem to have reached some sort of a ceiling which is invisible and not able to push through it simply because they are women. Only 7% of women work in professional, technical, or managerial occupations. Now, that is an extremely meager number. A large proportion of women who are employed in agricultural work and production lines, like diamond factories or biscuit factories. So it is not really any sort of work that, where their own willpower or decision-making or expertise is taken into consideration. Exposure to media. Women have lower access to media than men in every age group. About 71% of women are exposed to media as compared to 88% in case of men. 29% of women do not have access to media regularly. Since it is an important source of empowerment, greater proportion of women without having access to media reflects the relatively disadvantageous position of women in relation to men with regards to empowerment. Why am I saying that there is less exposure to media? Is because, yes, now there are cell phones and televisions that have reached a lot of places, but they are still controlled by the men in the family. Women are largely not given smartphones. They're generally bought basic phones, of course, beyond our urban habitat. And because most women in such places are not really educated so much, they're unable to even read newspapers. So this is how they have been curtailed from the exposure to media. Which brings us to another and last point that I had mentioned, domestic violence. If you look at the graphs I have here, it's a little old survey, but nevertheless, there are different countries that we are looking at. And if you see, India ranks second highest. And what are we talking about? It is women and men who agree that wife beating is acceptable if a wife argues with her husband. So basically, you are not supposed to question, you are not supposed to argue, you are not supposed to have an opinion. And if you have an opinion and if you were to express that, which was against the opinion of your husband, then it was okay for the husband to beat you. So 26% men agreed to this. But what is shocking is 30% women also agreed to this. So if you put that together, 56% people have agreed that women should be hit. That is a huge number. Women and men who agree that wife beating is acceptable if a wife refuses sex with a husband. Again, if you look at India, we're the second highest in this group. And you can see that it's about 14% women, which is much higher than the men. But this is the way we have been socialized. This is the way it has been drilled into our heads that we are subordinate to the man in the family, that he is the head of the family, that he is the decision maker of the family, that you are supposed to simply follow what is being told to you. So that is totally being drilled into a lot of the women also. And now they themselves seem to have these beliefs, which is detrimental to women at large. So what are ways to empower women? What do we need to do? We need to have changes in women's mobility and social interaction, which means that they should be able to get out of their houses by themselves in a safe manner and have the liberty to interact with friends, with other people, with politicians, just engage themselves socially. Changes in women labor patterns, which means we need to see more women in the professional work front rather than the blue collar jobs. We need to see changes in women's access to and control over resources, whether it is money, whether it is any other resource. changes in women's control over decision making. And irrespective of whether women are educated or not, or have the money or not, that they have some control in making decisions and that their voice is heard and accepted. Let's look at some inspirations. If you can identify, these women have been like a beacon of light for a lot of us. Mother Teresa, Indira Gandhi, Kiran Bedi, Kalpana Chawla, Sania Mirza, and many more, which obviously you can't see here, Sudha Murthy, there's Neela Satyanarayan. And all of these women have been successful. They have been able to put forth their opinion. They have been able to be good leaders. They have been able to have a followership. And why has that been possible? One of the key weapons that they had is that of education. And that is why I say that education is indispensable for women in India now. It is the most effective way to improve lives and health of a family and society. A woman with education is a powerful person, and you will see why I'm saying that. She has the power to educate the children in her family. If you are well educated, you will make sure your further generations are better educated. Empowered women contribute to the development in numerous ways. So if I am empowered as a woman, I will help another woman, another woman, another woman. But what will happen as a ripple effect is that entire family will then tend to see a change. And that will create a good ripple effect, which will lead our country in various dimensions to move towards growth. And which is why education is important power that shapes the lives of mankind. Till date, whatever advancement that we have made as a mankind is thanks to our education, is thanks to science and technology. Today, we can see that we have grown by leaps and bounds simply because we have the ability to read, to write, and to transmit this knowledge to a lot of other people. It empowers with the ability to think, reason, take appropriate decisions, and protect oneself from oppression and abuse. I think this is the center stone of education. Why? Because it empowers one to think, to question, is this right? Why am I doing this? What is the purpose of my life? Why do I have to do this? Is this in alignment with the purpose of my life? If not, what can I do to change it? So it allows you to reason. It allows you to take appropriate decisions, which means that you just don't have to follow orders blindly, but you can think for yourself, assess the situation, and then act appropriately. And when you're doing this, of course, then you're going to be able to stand up for yourself, to have a voice, to have a definite stance. And that is how one can protect oneself from oppression and abuse. Of course, there will be a growth in the GDP of the country. Educated women are able to take charge of their future. Once you are educated, and what does only educated mean? Not just the degree. Education comes from the word educare, which means to bring out, to hone, to polish. So any skill that you have, you need to hone it, to polish it. It gives you a sense of discipline. And that is obviously going to help you take charge of your future, that there will be a goal, that you have to move towards that goal. And education will help you see the steps, the smaller steps towards the larger goal. Obviously, it will help women earn and contribute to their family income. It helps reduces child and maternal mortality. The more educated the woman is, the better care she can take of herself and her child. Of course, they're better equipped to take care of their children. It lowers exposure to domestic abuse. Why? Domestic abuse largely has been working around the idea of economic dependence. Once a woman is educated and she has the ability to go out and earn, then that takes away the power from the men. And that is how it lowers the exposure to domestic violence. Have great confidence and takes right decision. This is also a very important thing. It boosts your self-esteem. It allows you to have some sense of self-efficacy, which makes you feel good about yourself. And that is why you can make and take right decisions. Or even if you take wrong decisions, you are able to be confident in taking those. You're able to take responsibility for the decisions you make. Contributes in a positive way to the society and nation at large. Including women in politics tends to have a different growth dimension. More and more women need to become participative. They need to participate in the social, economic, and political structure of our society. It is only if we become leaders that we will be able to pave a better way, a stronger way, a wider way for the other women to follow. Also, our voices will be heard more realistically by the others in society. To conclude, what I'd like to say is that over the years, the literacy rate among Indian women has increased from 10% to 41%, according to the last census, which is a very good increase, but we are still only at 41.5%. So a large chunk of women are still illiterate, which means that they are still vulnerable. Obviously, Indian government has launched a number of programs to encourage education for women. We who are educated need to be learned or have knowledge of these programs so we can take or make use of them as well as spread this awareness to other women in society. Women population are equipped with the power of education, most definitely. I'd like to end by saying, educating a boy is educating a person. Educating a girl is educating a nation. Education opens up a whole new world of opportunities for a girl and her ability to guide her children. Educating women is the single most profitable investment in developing countries. I just hope everyone, including people who are not even listening to us right now, sees this. Be the change you want to see. Start with yourself. Educate yourself. Polish yourself. Excel at what you're doing. Find a purpose. Walk that way, so that others will be motivated and inspired by what you do. Yeah, I'm just trying to come back.
Hi, Kanika. I think that was an extremely inspirational talk, and we have a couple of questions, Kanika, for you from the chat box. Aisha Qureshi has written that I think in a patriarchal society, we need nothing more than women empowerment to ensure equal opportunities. Please comment.
Absolutely. The whole problem in our society is that we are a patriarchal society. And so whatever women do, basically, it doesn't translate into worth or value simply because they are not contributing financially. I'm not saying that every person has to go out and do a job and earn money and, you know, be career oriented, so to say. Even if you're home, you are of value. Even if you're taking care of your family, you are of value. Because all of the things that you do at home, if you were paid for those jobs, you would earn much more than what men earn. So definitely what you say is absolutely true. That's the reason why women need to be empowered.
There is another question, Kanika, which says, a lot of women feel guilty when they break the glass ceiling due to external disapproval and a hostile work environment. How can they deal with this?
Okay. Tough question. Generally, glass ceiling generally comes very often in relation to the corporate job. And when women are willing to take up a corporate job, I think they have to be in their head quiet, sure of what they're doing. And because you're sure and you know where you want to go, you know that there will be obstacles and you know that you have to break through them. I don't understand why one has to feel guilty about it. Yes, one can feel upset that other people are hostile, that they disapprove of your success, that, you know, I know a lot of people who are at higher positions and they have been reprimanded by their male colleagues because they've taken maternity leaves, something that you are entitled to. But because men don't get those, they kind of do not like the idea that, oh, you're getting a paid leave, like for 6 months, you will not be doing anything and you'll be paid for that. So I know that this sort of hostility does exist, but I don't think one needs to feel guilty about it. One needs to look at it from, I think, an angle of, you know, they don't know what they're saying. You know what you want to do. You know what your goal is. So there is absolutely no reason to feel guilty. Just go ahead, shatter all the glasses and let them prick.
Thank you, Kanika. I think there's another question. Oh my God, this is a really long one. So Kanika, there's a student who's written, it's highly problematic to address a women's empowerment issue by directing attention to their education being a purpose of generating more educated heirs, because that takes away from the responsibility of their partners to live up to their own responsibility of parenthood, and therefore make the whole idea of empowerment completely redundant.
Okay. So the thing is, if you look at the way that we have, you know, moved from where we were to where we are right now, you will notice that largely children's education was related to their mothers. And I understand where you're coming from, where you're trying to say that both partners need to parent the child equally and spend time equally. And I totally agree, and I also follow that in my real life. But it is a very utopian concept, let me tell you that. Different people have different work schedules. Different people are engaged in different sort of responsibilities. And so it may happen that you may teach or not teach your child. But what I'm trying to say is that if you are educated and if you are able to teach the child, then it'll be only more beneficial. I don't see how it'll become redundant, because you can still have the right and the voice to tell your partner that this is how much I am going to be doing. This is how much is expected of you, isn't it? Because you are going to feel empowered. And it is not just about creating educated heirs. It is just the fact that the woman largely, even today, even if we are empowered, educated, working XYZ, by nature, we are nurturing. By nature, we are the primary caregivers of our children. And that is why there is probably slightly more responsibility with the mother to take care of their children, probably because of the natural connect with the child. And probably that is why if you are educated, you will inspire the child, motivate the child to be more educated, study well, take life more seriously. So I don't think it will really make the idea of women empowerment redundant. It will only help you to be more assertive with your partner, with your children. Your children will also learn the same assertiveness skills.
Thank you, Kanika. I hope that answers your question, Aisha. There's another question in the chat box which asks, is education the only way to empowerment?
No, it's not the only way to empowerment, but it is one of the strongest weapons we have. And the reason I say that it is the strongest is because we can quantify education, right? And today, whether you like it or not, the world is slightly materialistic place, and the value or worth of a person is somehow decided by the money he earns, the work they do, right? Today, a lot of people feel that, oh, housewife, oh, that's okay. She's like, you know, she's just somebody. But the same place you say, oh, I'm a professor in college, or oh, I'm a doctor in a hospital, then the way people look at you, you know, is different. Unfortunate, it's very unfortunate, but it's true. So if that is to be done, then, you know, if you have to shut people today, then you have to shut people in the way they want to be shut. And so that's why education may help, because it's a recognized degree. So nobody can say that, you know, she's just saying, oh, you know, she's not really capable, but she's just saying that she can do all of this. That just becomes not possible, because then you have a paper to show that, well, this is what you have done. Education, why I say it is important, is because it also teaches you a lot of other life skills. One being discipline. You know, you can't just haphazardly go through your educational life. You know that you have exams, you have to study, there is a method to it. So it inculcates the idea of discipline, inculcates the idea of time management, of multitasking. And these skills are very handy life skills to have. So I'm not saying only academic education, even non-academic education when it comes to arts, performing arts, fine arts, any of that also requires some amount of education, and that can also help you to become self-reliant. I think eventually self-reliance is what makes you, you know, empowered. So whatever it takes to get there.
Great. Thank you, Kanika. I think that is just one last question. Do you see the world in near future with all girls educated? Difficult question to answer.
I wish for that future. I pray for that future. I pray really sincerely for that future. But I know that in the near future, I don't see that happening so soon. So you just see, from the time we began to now, we are at 41.6%. So for another 60%, we will really have to create a momentum. So you understand that the efforts that have been put by the other women till date have been phenomenal. And that is the very reason why we are where we are today. But if we want to see a lot of other people where we are today, then all of us will have to empower ourselves and others at a rapid speed beginning today.
Thank you so much, Kanika. I think you've answered all the questions that were there in the chat box. So over to you, Vaishnavi, to propose the vote of thanks. Thank you so much, Kanika, for taking time out from your busy schedule. This was a very short notice, but I really appreciate your inputs. And I have a lot of, surprisingly, we have a lot of girl students in our college. And yeah, it really makes me feel good, you know, and I hope the take-home message today would be that, you know, education is the way to empowerment. And formal education, yes, is also important. Thank you, Kanika. Thank you so much. Over to you, Vaishnavi.
Thank you, Meena ma'am. And thank you, Kanika ma'am, for sharing with us your valuable insight. You're truly an inspiration for all of us. We'd also like to thank you for taking time out of your busy schedule and addressing us today. It was truly a pleasure having you here with us. I now invite Meena ma'am to present the vote of thanks.
So thank you all participants, esteemed speakers, for taking time out today and sharing your views. Thank you to students for being present today and being a part of Dr. Abdul Kalamji's birth anniversary. And today is your day because it's the World Students Day. And I need to extend a warm gratitude to all the present TY psychology students. Each of them have contributed in making today's program very successful, very short notice, very well done. Thank you to all of you for the technical bit, for hosting the program, for the backstage program. And thank you to our esteemed speakers, Kanika ma'am, Janet, Shreya, for giving in your inputs from different perspectives. I'm sure the students have understood that education is very important, self-growth is very important, developing life skills is very important. Thank you. So this is a note to all the students that you will receive your certificates once you fill in the feedback form, which will be put up in the WhatsApp group and in the chat right now. You need to fill it up and allow us a day or two to forward the certificates to you. Thank you once again to everyone for being part. This event could not have been put in place, like always, without the support of Dr. Professor Milind Kulkarni, sir, and his team member, Vivek Makwan, sir. Thank you so much once again for allowing us to use Zoom, coordinating the live YouTube. Thank you to in-charge principal, Dr. Neha Jagtiani, for sending us a welcome note. And once again, we hope we meet again soon with another event. Thank you. Asha, you can put the feedback link in the chat box, please. Milind sir, I think yes. We are done. Thank you so much, Milind sir. Yes, thank you very much.
Thank you. Nice presentation, ma'am. So can
thank
I...
Thank you, sir. Yes, sir. You can put off the live thing.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much.